A very good morning. You're watching the Breakfast News on Rajya Sabha Television. My name is Aishwarya Kapoor. Let us start the news bulletin with the headlines. Prime Minister Modi and BJP Chief Amit Shah to meet Chief Ministers of 15 BJP-ruled states today. Discussions on preparations for Lok Sabha elections and upcoming assembly polls to take stock of works going on in states ruled by the party. Flying of drones to be legal in India from 1st of December this year. Delivery of a payload, including food items, not allowed for now as government announces regulations. Civilian operations restricted during daytime to the maximum of 400 feet altitude. Supreme Court to hear matter on granting interim relief to power companies against strict deadline for finalizing resolution plans for NPAs. Allahabad High Court had refused to grant interim relief against the RBI deadline that ended on Monday. Donald Trump says the US has reached a really good deal with Mexico to rewrite the North American Free Trade Agreement. Holds constructive conversation with Canadian Prime Minister as trade negotiations with Canadian representative begin in Washington today. And India looked to add to its gold medal tally today as PV Sindhu plays a badminton singles match final at the Asian Games. Men's and women's compound teams also aim for gold in their final matches today. India's overall medal tally in games at 41. Our top story this morning, the meeting of chief ministers of BJP-ruled states will take place in the national capital today. And Prime Minister Narendra Modi and BJP Chief Amit Shah will be meeting 15 chief ministers of the party as it gears up for the Lok Sabha elections slated next year. The party top brass will also take stock of the works going on in the states ruled by the party. The meeting assumes also significance as the assembly polls are due in three states ruled by the party, namely Madhya Pradesh, Chhattisgarh and Rajasthan. The agenda of good governance and running pro-poor policies has been a key feature of the chief ministers' meetings, which have been taking place regularly since Mr. Modi took over as prime minister in 2014. BJP's deputy chief ministers in different states will also attend the day-long meeting to be held at the party headquarters today. All right, let's get more details. We have with us our colleague Panchanan Mishra joining us from the national capital. Panchanan, in the run-up to the 2019 general elections, as well as, you know, there are assembly elections that are slated in three states. Of course, PM Modi and BJP Chief Amit Shah will chair this meeting of the chief ministers of the BJP ruled states. So what all are the issues that are likely to be discussed in this meeting today?
Of course, Aishwarya, the core issue is the preparations for the upcoming Lok Sabha elections and the four state assembly elections which is slated to last of this year. So this is the, you may say, the core agenda of the meeting, but this is a regular meeting of chief ministers which happens in every 6 months. Yes. But ahead of the election, it is crucial because Prime Minister Narendra Modi and BJP President Amit Shah, along with the party dignitaries and 15 state chief ministers and deputy CMs of party also, will meet here, will take stock of the development work and developmental schemes, particularly running in the country. And there will be different sessions in this day-long meeting, which will begin around at this at 10 a.m. In this party headquarter. And in these sessions, there may be presentation of government's flagship schemes. And the recent example is the launch of Ayushman Bharat. There may be a presentation and a session dedicated to this scheme because the government is thinking that it may be a game-changer scheme, and which was announced on this 15th August by the Prime Minister Narendra Modi himself. So, apart from these schemes, good governance is a core agenda, and discussions with CM to implement how a better implementation can be of the policies for the welfare of people and for also keeping an eye on the Lok Sabha elections. So, deliberations will be a day long, and different sessions will be there, and leaders will take stock of all developmental work and also the preparations for these assembly and Lok Sabha elections. Aishwarya.
Right. Thank you so much, Panchanan, for all those updates there. And as Panchanan was telling us, of course, the meeting, of, among other things, will deal with measures to promote and spread awareness about the welfare schemes that have been initiated by the Modi government. On to some other news now. The Election Commission held an all-party meeting on Monday to discuss crucial electoral issues ahead of the 2019 Lok Sabha elections and for upcoming state elections. And raising concerns over the EVM tampering, the opposition parties urged the poll panel to revert to the old system of a ballot paper for voting. The Election Commission has said that it would take a comprehensive view of those concerns.
The Election Commission on Monday called a meeting of all political parties to discuss various issues ahead of the 2019 Lok Sabha elections and upcoming assembly elections in four states. In the meeting, many opposition parties raised issues of EVM tampering, technical glitches in the VVPAT system, funding for elections and fidelity of the electoral rolls. The Election Commission said it would take a comprehensive view and provide a satisfactory solution to the concerns raised by the political parties.
चिंताएं ईवीएम वीवीपैट और दूसरी चीजों के बारे में उन्होंने व्यक्त की हैं उन सब पर कॉम्प्रिहेंसिव व्यू लेकर इलेक्शन कमीशन उनके प्रति संतोषजनक हल प्रदान करेगा.
The meeting was attended by representatives of the 7 national parties and 51 regional parties. The Congress said that over 70% of the political parties have pitched for reverting to the old voting system of ballot paper instead of the EVMs. The opposition parties also demanded ceiling on expenditure by the political parties during the poll campaign.
ये देखा गया है कि बटन आप मशीन पर कोई भी दबाओ लेकिन वोट किसी एक राजनीतिक दल को ही जा रहा है तो यह हमारे राजनीति के लिए यह कोई स्वस्थ बात नहीं है.
प्रिंट मीडिया, इलेक्ट्रॉनिक मीडिया, सोशल मीडिया, ये सब 48 घंटे पहले जो प्रचार बंद हो जाता है इन पे भी हर तरह का प्रचार बंद होना चाहिए. और प्री पोल सर्वे जिस दिन से चुनाव की घोषणा हो इलेक्शन कमीशन द्वारा उसी दिन से रोक देना चाहिए.
हम लोगों ने ये बात रखी कि जो इलेक्शन होना चाहिए वो बैलेट पेपर से होना चाहिए. ईवीएम जो है एक इलेक्ट्रॉनिक आइटम है जो कि हर इलेक्ट्रॉनिक आइटम की तरह वो भी हैक हो सकता है और पिछला हम लोगों का ये एक्सपीरियंस है कि ये हैक हुआ है.
पॉलिटिकल पार्टी उसी को चंदा दिया जाता है जो उसके बदले कुछ दे सकते हैं सत्ता में आने के बाद और वो हमारे ख्याल में सबसे बड़ा देश के अंदर भ्रष्टाचार और घोटाले का स्रोत है.
वी थिंक वी शुड लुक फॉरवर्ड, वी शुड गो फॉरवर्ड एंड वी शुड नॉट बी लुकिंग बैक. And just because creating reasons for unnecessarily irrational reasons should not be there.
The BJP called the demand of opposition parties to return to the ballot paper a regressive move, saying it's just an attempt to cover up their own defeats in the recently concluded polls. The representatives also presented their views on alternative modes of voting for domestic migrants and absentee voters and better representation of women in political parties. Panchanan Mishra's report for Rajya Sabha TV.
On to some other news. Health and Family Welfare Minister JP Nadda has said that the government will crack down on fake websites asking people to enroll for the Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana. The scheme will cover 5 lakh per family per year. 10.74 crore poor and vulnerable families are entitled to get the benefits under this socio-economic caste census.
Launching the logo of Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana on Monday, Health and Family Welfare Minister JP Nadda said that the government has a foolproof plan to avoid duplication of beneficiaries. Nadda said that there will be a QR code in each letter through which beneficiaries would be identified.
Pita ka naam, bete ka naam, bacche kitne hain, sari cheeze usme QR code mein hoga. To hum puchenge, batao, bete ka kitne hain tumhare, kya naam hai unka? तो उससे हमको पता चलेगा कि लेटर होल्डर इज द रियल पर्सन एंड द पर्सन हु इज देयर ही इज हिमसेल्फ द सेम पर्सन. ये दोनों चीजों की आइडेंटिफिकेशन होनी है.
द सर्विसेज विल इंक्लूड 1350 प्रोसीजर्स कवरिंग प्री एंड पोस्ट हॉस्पिटलाइजेशन, डायग्नोस्टिक्स एंड मेडिसिन. स्टेट्स आर गिवन फ्लेक्सिबिलिटी टू डिसाइड ऑन मोड ऑफ इम्प्लीमेंटेशन. बेनिफिट्स विल बी पोर्टेबल अक्रॉस द कंट्री एंड पेमेंट्स विल बी कैशलेस एंड पेपरलेस टू पैनल हॉस्पिटल्स.
जब वल्नरेबल सेक्शन, मार्जिनल सेक्शन को 5 लाख रुपए की हेल्थ कवरेज की कैपेसिटी आएगी तो निश्चित रूप से हॉस्पिटल्स विल डेवलप. लेकिन जब तक डेवलप नहीं है तब तक दे विल बी रेफर टू अदर इंस्टीट्यूशंस, अदर डिस्ट्रिक्ट हॉस्पिटल्स वेयर द फैसिलिटी इज देयर. इवन द इम्पैनल हॉस्पिटल्स कैन टेक केयर. हमको उसमें कोई आपत्ति नहीं है. हमारे तरफ से ये ज़रूर है कि अगर वो गवर्नमेंट हॉस्पिटल में जाते हैं तो गवर्नमेंट हॉस्पिटल को ये बेनिफिट होगा कि वो उसको जो हम पेमेंट करेंगे वो पैसा उसी हॉस्पिटल में रह जाएगा. दैट इज़ नॉट गोइंग टू कम बैक टू द ट्रेजरी. तो वो हॉस्पिटल्स भी अब मजबूत होंगे.
Prime Minister Modi had on August 15th announced rollout of world's largest health scheme from September 25th on the birth anniversary of Pandit Deendayal Upadhyay. Kriti Mishra, Rajya Sabha TV.
On to the other top story of the day, the RBI's deadline on the resolution of problem of NPAs or bad loans ended on Monday, and today the Supreme Court will hear the matter on granting interim relief to power companies against the strict deadline set by the RBI. Remember, the RBI had set a six-month time frame for finalizing the resolution plans for around 70 large stressed accounts worth over 3.8 lakh crore rupees, and on Monday, the Allahabad High Court had also refused to grant interim relief against the RBI circular. Here are the details.
Failing to reach a resolution plan, banks will now have no option but to drag defaulters to the National Company Law Tribunal to initiate bankruptcy proceedings. The banks had hoped their resolution plans for NPA accounts would help avoid going to the NCLT, which would result in large haircuts. A haircut is the difference between the loan amount and the actual value of the asset used as collateral.
There cannot be two issues that in case a person has diverted money and misused the money, then strict action should follow. So giving such deadline of one day default and the 6 month resolution probably is going to be a challenge. And I say today, the 70 odd companies which are facing this problem, having a somewhere, I believe, 380,000 crore rupees of the default law on the loan, is going to be a big challenge. Many of these companies are in the power sector. We all know that power sector is passing through a difficult phase. There are stressed assets. What are the projections, estimation, the profitability, the fund flow they have worked out are not happening because of the rates going down, cost being out of the proportion. So all those challenges are coming up.
The Allahabad High Court has refused to grant interim relief against the RBI circular. The Supreme Court will now hear the matter today on granting interim relief to power companies against the deadline. The RBI, in its 12 February circular, tightened norms for settling bad debt by setting timelines for resolving non-performing assets. The central bank also introduced the concept of a one-day default, under which banks have to identify incipient stress even when repayments are overdue by a day. The circular came into effect on March 1st and the 180-day deadline concluded on Monday. Kriti Mishra's report for Rajya Sabha TV.
Meanwhile, Finance Minister Arun Jaitley addressed the annual general meeting of the Indian Banks Association through video conferencing on Monday, and he said that the banks play an important role in nation building by helping the industry and also common people. He added that the banking sector in the country is growing at a fast pace and banking services are reaching every person. The finance minister also informed that the government and the RBI are taking steps to tackle the challenges being faced by the banking sector.
We built in the third phase struggle to find methodologies of how to effect recoveries. The Reserve Bank came out with certain schemes, the bankers tried it. We had created a system where we had reduced the ability of our bankers also to find solutions, because the regime under which we wanted them to function was not a regime of comfort.
And the government on Monday unveiled its first drone or use of unmanned aircraft policy. And the commercial use of drones across sectors such as agriculture, health and disaster relief in accordance with the regulations will come into force from 1st of December this year. However, the delivery of payload, including food items, would not be allowed as of now. All civilian drone operations will be restricted only during the daytime, and flying will be restricted within the visual line of sight, which is usually would be 400 feet. The regulation prevents the drones from flying around airports, near international border, near coastline, state secretariat complexes, vital and military installations, and Vijay Chowk in New Delhi. And except nano drones and those owned by the National Technical Research Organization and the Central Intelligence Agencies, the rest would be registered and issued a unique identification number. Users of the nano drone, which weighs less than 250 gram and flies up to 50 feet, are exempted from securing permission, including from local police. But micro drones are flying up to 200 feet and small drones flying over 450 feet and above will have to require police permission.
Important development to bring in new technology in India, and this market could be over a period of time over $1 trillion. Our idea is that because of its more and more use, intensive use in India, we'll not only be able to manufacture it for Indian market, but over a period of time we will be even manufacturing it for global markets. And that's the scale at which India could immensely benefit from this activity.
So the first set of regulations that we are releasing today, we are formalizing today, is going to provide an opportunity for people to really get going with these drone technologies. They are, the equal, if not better than anywhere else in the world in terms of an overall regulatory framework for drones. Obviously, right now, it's all visual line of sight, but we will be allowing you to go up to 400 feet. And importantly, we are going to be using an all-digital platform to enable you to get the drone operator permit, to get your drone registered, and to get your flight registered.
And now let's get you all the updates from flood-ravaged Kerala. In Kerala, over 3.26 lakh people are still in relief camps across the state, even after a fortnight of the devastating floods. Chief Minister Pinarayi Vijayan has ordered immediate relief of 10,000 rupees to be distributed soon to the flood affected. Though several people are returning to their homes, the Chief Minister said that relief camps have to be continued for a few more days. The work of burying carcasses of the birds and animals killed in the floods is also nearing completion. The contribution towards the Chief Minister's Disaster Relief Fund touched 700 crore rupees on Monday. Telecom authorities said that 98% connectivity have been restored in flood-hit areas. Meanwhile, Congress President Rahul Gandhi will be paying a two-day visit to the state beginning today. He would visit some relief camps and also meet fishermen and party volunteers involved in relief work. Rahul Gandhi will be visiting Alappuzha, Chengannur and Ernakulam today, and some places in Wayanad and Kozhikode districts tomorrow. And let's get you some weather updates from the other states of the country. Fresh rain lashed several parts of Uttar Pradesh, even as the state continued to reel under the impact of torrential rain and floods in many districts. 12 people lost their lives and 8 others were injured in rain-related incidents. Met Department has forecast heavy rains in some parts of the states to continue. And water level of Ghagra River is rising continuously due to heavy rains in the region. 44 villages were marooned in the water of Ghagra in Azamgarh district, forcing hundreds of inhabitants to migrate to safer places. Meanwhile, heavy rains also hit several parts of the national capital in the wee hours on Tuesday. Heavy rains accompanied with lightning was reported around Indira Gandhi International Airport, as well as Teen Murti Bhavan and R.K. Pura, among other areas. And heavy rains also disrupted normal life in Chhattisgarh. Rivers and rivulets are in spate and flood-like situation is prevailing in several districts of the state. Gates of several dams have also been opened, leading to sudden rise in water levels in Mahanadi and other rivers in the state. In the state capital, Raipur, almost all low-lying areas have been inundated and administration has declared holiday for the schools, and Met Department has predicted heavy rains during the next 24 hours as well. And the centre and six states will sign an agreement for the construction of a Lakhwar multi-purpose project in the upper Yamuna basin in Uttarakhand today. Water Resources Ministry will sign the agreement with the states of Uttar Pradesh, Rajasthan, Uttarakhand, Haryana, Delhi and Himachal Pradesh. Under the project, a 204-metre-high concrete dam with a live storage capacity of 330.66 million cubic metres across the Yamuna near Lohari village in Dehradun district will be constructed. Now, this storage is aimed at providing irrigation to 33,780 hectares land and availability of 78.83 MCM water for domestic, drinking and industrial use in the six basin states. The project, which is to be executed by Uttarakhand Jal Vidyut Nigam Limited, is expected to generate 300 megawatts of power for Uttarakhand. On to some other news now. External Affairs Minister Sushma Swaraj inaugurated the third Indian Ocean Conference in Vietnam's capital Hanoi on Monday. And speaking at the inaugural event, Sushma Swaraj hailed the role played by the Indian community residing in Vietnam in consolidating cultural connect between the two nations. She also praised the Indian diaspora for strengthening people-to-people bond between India and Vietnam. The conference ends today.
Friends, it is self-evident, therefore, that those who live in this region bear the primary responsibility for peace, stability and prosperity in the Indian Ocean. It is equally valid that it is only through collective action that we can meet these challenges. It is in this context that I wish to underline that we see ASEAN as central to the regional maritime architecture. This was recognized by our leaders during the ASEAN-India Commemorative Summit in January this year. In the Delhi Declaration issued to mark this occasion, we reiterated the importance of maintaining and promoting peace, stability and maritime safety and security and freedom of navigation and overflight.
Meanwhile, she also met Sri Lankan Prime Minister Ranil Wickremesinghe and her Japanese counterpart Taro Kono. She also met Bangladesh's Minister of Planning Mustafa Kamal. Our top international focus now. The United States and Mexico agreed on Monday to overhaul the North American Free Trade Agreement, or NAFTA, putting pressure on Canada to agree to the new terms to remain the part of the three-nation pact. U.S. President Donald Trump, a frequent critic of the existing deal, announced the breakthrough on Monday. Donald Trump and outgoing Mexican President Enrique Peña Nieto said that talks with Canada would begin immediately, though Donald Trump threatened that he could put tariffs on Canadian-made cars if a three-way deal could not be reached. Mexico also said that the deal would move forward with or without Canada. Negotiations between the three trade partners have dragged on for more than a year, and repeated threats by Donald Trump that he would ditch the 1994 accord have roiled financial markets, putting pressure on the Mexican peso as well as the Canadian dollar. Donald Trump demanded the renegotiation of the trade agreement, which he blames for a decline in the U.S. manufacturing jobs, especially in the auto industry. Canadian trade negotiator will hold discussions beginning today in Washington. Canadian Prime Minister Justin Trudeau spoke to Donald Trump ahead of the talks and termed it as a constructive conversation.
This is something that's very special for our manufacturers and for our farmers from both countries, for all of the people that work for jobs. It's also great trade, and it makes it a much more fair bill. And we are very, very excited about it.
And the mass killings of Rohingya in Myanmar's Rakhine state constitute genocide, and top military commanders should face prosecution for crimes against humanity, says a team of United Nations investigators. The independent UN investigation into alleged human rights abuses carried out against Rohingya Muslims in Myanmar has called for the country's military leaders to be prosecuted for genocide, crimes against humanity and war crimes. The report recommends that the case be referred to the International Criminal Court in The Hague or for an ad hoc tribunal to be created to investigate the actions of the alleged perpetrators. Six military leaders have been named in this report. Further, UN investigators said that the Myanmar's civilian government contributed to the commission of atrocity crimes through their acts and omissions. It said that State Councillor Aung San Suu Kyi did not use her de facto position as head of government to stem or prevent the unfolding of events in the Rakhine state.
The fact-finding mission has concluded on reasonable grounds that the patterns of gross human rights violations and serious violations of international humanitarian law that it has found amount to the gravest crimes under international law. These have principally been committed by the military, the Tatmadaw. The mission has concluded that criminal investigation and prosecution is warranted, focusing on the top Tatmadaw generals in relation to the three categories of crimes under international law: genocide, crimes against humanity, and war crimes.
And now let's get you all the action from the Asian Games. Added 5 medals on Monday of the 18th Asian Games to take its medal tally to 41. And India will today hope that the gold rush continues with the women's compound team and men's compound team gunning for glory in archery. And in badminton, PV Sindhu will also take on Tai Tzu Ying in the women's singles final today. And earlier on Monday, Neeraj Chopra became the first Indian javelin thrower to win an Asian Games gold medal after shattering his own national record by clearing a distance of 88.06 meters. The President, Vice President and Prime Minister Modi congratulated Neeraj for his achievement. Meanwhile, Dharun Ayasemi also won a silver medal in 400 meter hurdles. Dharun claimed the second position after finishing the event in 48.96 seconds. And Nina Varakil gave India another silver medal in athletics after she came second in the women's long jump event. She won the second position with her best jump of 6.51 meters. And in the women's 3,000 meters steeplechase, Sudha Singh bagged the silver medal. She clogged 9 minutes 40.03 seconds to win her second Asian Games medal. And in badminton, ace Indian shuttler PV Sindhu assured India of at least a silver medal after defeating Akane Yamaguchi of Japan, while Saina Nehwal settled for bronze in the same event after losing her semi-final clash to Tai Tzu Ying of Taiwan. And in boxing, Vikas Krishnan and Amit Panghal advanced to the quarterfinals. Vikas defeated Pakistan's Tanveer Ahmed in 75kg pre-quarterfinal bout, while Amit beat a Mongolian rival in the 49kg weight category to make it to the quarterfinals. And looking at the medals tally, India is placed ninth with 41 medals that include 8 gold, 13 silver and 20 bronze medals. That's it in this edition of Breakfast News. Thanks for watching. Have a great day ahead.